I'm Scott Denning. I'm a professor of atmospheric science at Colorado State University, and I'm director of education for a big climate modeling center there called CMAP.
You have some unique experience among many of the scientists here in that you have spent a lot of time reaching out to people on the skeptical side.
Sure.
And I think you've got some interesting experiences in that area, and I'd like to hear about them. For instance, you have spoken at a Heartland convention, which is, if anybody doesn't know, a hardcore climate denial organization. So what can you tell us about that?
Well, it was an incredible experience. It was really very moving for me. It was a meaningful thing to do. I was invited in 2011 to go speak to their annual conference, which was in Chicago in the downtown Marriott, huge ballroom, you know, 600 people, something like that. Anyway, big room full of people. At the reception, in the registration packs, they were handing out these hockey sticks, mini hockey sticks, about 18 inches long, made out of plywood. Said man made climate change with two N's, like, you know, Mike Mann made climate change. And they were holding them in their hands out there in the audience. It was just kind of a scary moment to step in front of hundreds of stick wielding people who vehemently don't believe in climate change, quote unquote. And I you know, first they were sort of all very guarded body language, but as I went through my routine and I said, pretty much told them the same thing I told all audiences. They gave themselves 15 minutes to rebut me, which was interesting. So they gave most of the speakers had 15 minutes, and then whatever time they didn't use, they had Q&A. But for me, they gave me 30 minutes and 15 minutes for Q&A after my talk. And I was spooked by that. You know, I'm going to have 600 hostile people doing Q&A. Better be ready. But the questions were very, very easy. The questions are the same, you know, pseudo-skeptic questions that we see all the time. And of course we know how to answer those questions. So it was within a few minutes, I see how this is going to go. And they would ask me one of these sort of obvious things, what about warming since 1998, or what about the sun, or natural cycles, and of course, somebody who's doing this all the time can easily answer every one of these questions in a very convincing way. And within about 5 minutes, they decided to stop the Q&A. So that was kind of fun. And I think maybe the most gratifying thing was that, I mean, and I'm sure I didn't change the minds of Joe Bast, Jay Lair, these people who run the Heartland Institute. But most of the people there are actually nice people, right? These are not evil people that go to these things. I would say a lot of them are misled. And a lot of these people, and I mean dozens of people over a period of a couple of days, would come up to me in the hallway in the hotel, in the elevator, at the bar, and say, thank you so much for coming. I never thought of it like that before. And it was like, whoa, they didn't want to say this in front of their friends, but when they could get me one-on-one, you know, in a sort of private setting, I know that I made a difference with some dozens of people out of an audience of 600. So it was good. And believe it or not, they invited me back. They liked it. They invited me back. Second year, they gave me both a 15-minute talk and an hour-long lunchtime plenary debate with Roy Spencer on climate change. And it was very structured, you know. You're going to have 5 minutes, you're going to have 5 minutes, then there's going to be give and take, then we're going to have Q&A from the audience, then you have a closing statement, something like that. It went very well. I encourage you to watch it on YouTube. Roy Spencer is a real scientist. He is not just an ideologue. He's not crazy. And I found him supporting my position when some of the Q&A from the audience was off the wall wrong. For example, Fred Singer was in the audience, and he said, "Well, Scott, we know that the CO2 absorption lines are completely saturated and that adding extra CO2 will not change the absorption of the atmosphere." And before I could even say anything, Roy Spencer said, "Fred, no, that's just not right. Our research of spectroscopy is based on those lines, and I can tell you that that's not correct." I was like, right on. So I actually, I enjoyed that debate. I felt that it went very strongly my way. And I actually felt like Roy Spencer helped make it go that way, which was unexpected. It was a pleasure doing it.
Would you go back and talk at Heartland again, and would you recommend other scientists do that?
I would. I would do it again. I know that there is this objection, that there is this sort of legitimizing thing. But as I said, those guys aren't going away. Not showing up isn't going to make them turn around and disappear. They treated me very well. They were not mean and ornery and insulting. They were very friendly and approachable. It doesn't always work out with my schedule. I'm not going to make it a priority, you know, to skip other stuff to go to Heartland. Sure. But I would definitely go to Heartland again. I would encourage people, not anybody, not everybody, if you're personally inclined to engage hostile audiences on climate change, there's no better hostile audience than something like Heartland. You know, they're the real McCoy in terms of opposing almost everything that we do.